What is scatter radiation? Scatter radiation is a secondary type of radiation that occurs when the useful beam intercepts with any object, causing some X-rays to be scattered away.
Compton scattering occurs between moderate energy X-rays and outer shell electrons. It results in ionization of the target atom, a change in X-ray direction, and a reduction in X-ray energy. The wavelength of the scattered X-ray is greater than that of the incident X-ray with less energy. Factors that affect scatter radiation. The patient is always the main source of scatter radiation during any fluoroscopic or X-ray examination. As scatter radiation increases, the radiographic image loses contrast and appears gray and dull. Three factors contribute to increased scatter radiation: increased patient thickness, increase in the X-ray field size, and an increase in KVP. Patient thickness cannot be controlled, and when it comes to imaging larger patients, there is an increase in scatter radiation because more X-rays undergo multiple scattering in all different directions. It is very important that a technologist chooses a proper technique in order to compensate for any body type.
X-ray field size and patient thickness play a huge role in scatter radiation. The larger the amount of tissue the beam is allowed to irradiate, the more scatter radiation is produced. Here is an example of how much scatter a patient can receive during exposure when the field size is much larger.
The most difficult task for the radiologic technologist involves the evaluation of the patient. The patient's size, shape, and physical condition greatly influences the radiographic technique, as well as the amount of scatter radiation that is produced. Body habitus. Patient A is a hypersthenic patient, which is an individual with a larger frame and is usually overweight. Patient B is sthenic. This means strong and active. Patients are considered to be the average patient. Patient C, hypostenic. These patients are thin but relatively healthy. And patient D, asthenic patients. These patients are small, frail, and often elderly. Hypostenic and asthenic patients produce the least amount of scatter because they require less technique. X-ray field size is another factor that affects the level of scatter radiation. Unlike patient thickness, this is a factor that can be controlled by the technologist. Scatter radiation increases as the X-ray beam field size increases. For example, image A shows an uncollimated AP lumbar spine, which is increasing scatter radiation because of the larger field size. In image B, it is representing proper collimation, thus reducing patient dose to only what is needed and also improving contrast. Extremities. There is a significant reduction in scatter radiation when imaging extremities because there is less tissue and because of their smaller field size. The final images appear sharper and clearer.
As mentioned before, there is a reduction in scatter radiation when imaging extremities because of their smaller field size. Here's an example of a hand and how little scatter radiation it receives during an exposure.
KVP is the primary control of X-ray beam quality and beam penetrability. When a high KVP technique is used, the amount of scatter is increased, just adding unwanted fog to the radiograph. This leads to a decrease in image contrast. On the other hand, high KVP techniques do reduce patient dose. It would be ideal for all radiographs to be taken at the lowest reasonable KVP because that would result in minimum scatter and thus higher image contrast.
A chest X-ray is an example of high KVP and low contrast.
What controls scatter radiation? There are two basic methods for the control of scatter: beam restricting devices and radiographic grids. Beam restrictors. Beam restrictors are devices that restrict the size of the X-ray field only to the anatomical structure of interest. This controls scatter radiation, improves contrast, and can reduce the patient dose. There are three types of beam restricting devices: aperture diaphragm, cones or cylinders, and the variable aperture collimator. Aperture diaphragm. They are the simplest of restrictors. They are lead or lead-lined metal diaphragm that covers just less than the size of the image receptor. They are most familiar in trauma settings and are used with a fixed SID. Cones and cylinders. These are modifications of the aperture diaphragm that extend to produce a restricted field size of a circular shape. The X-ray source, cone, and image receptor must be aligned, otherwise cone cutting can occur. Today, cones and cylinders are reserved primarily for examination of selected areas, such as sinuses.
Radiographic cones and cylinders produce restricted useful X-ray beams of circular shape. Notice how in this video the use of the cones funnel the beam to the anatomy of interest, therefore reducing scatter radiation and improving image contrast.
Variable aperture collimator. These are box-shaped device that contains a radiographic beam defining system. It is the most often used to reduce the size and the shape of the beam. It is equipped with first stage shutters to control off-focus radiation, as well as second stage collimator shutters to allow an infinite number of collimation sizes. Some X-rays are produced when projectile electrons stray and interact at positions on the anode other than the focal spot. This is what causes off-focus radiation and increases image blur.
This video demonstrates how collimation decreases scatter. With the collimation open, it allows the radiation to travel in all directions. With increasing the collimation, scatter radiation is then filtered so that radiation traveling in straight lines gets through.
This image demonstrates an example of off-focus radiation, as well as the construction of the variable collimator. Grids. Grids are used to reduce the intensity of scatter radiation in the remnant X-ray beam. It improves contrast, however, increased technique is required. Grids are made up of strips of opaque material and interspaced material, which is radiolucent. Scatter radiation is absorbed in the grid material, therefore it cleans the image up. Grid types. Parallel grid. These are constructed with parallel grid strips. With short SID, some grid cutoff may occur. The cross grid is a sandwiching of two parallel grids together so that the grid strips are perpendicular. If not properly aligned, grid off
grid cutoff occurs as well.
In this demonstration, the small cooling rack represents the radiographic grid. Notice how the grid only allows the scatter radiation, represented by the silly string, to only get through if it travels in the same angle as the holes of the rack, or the interspace material of a grid, while the other scatter is prevented to go through from the radiopaque material of the grid strips.
Grid types. There are two types of moving grids. Reciprocating grid moves back and forth. The oscillating grid moves in a circular motion. Disadvantages of these moving grids is that it requires a bulky mechanism, it increases OID, and motion to the cassette holding device. Focus grids are fabricated so that the grid strips are parallel to the X-ray path across the entire image receptor. It is marked with its intended focal distance and the side of the grid that should face the tube. Misalignment can result in off-level, off-center, off-focus upside down, or off-center, off-focus. This image shows a moving grid that is in common use today. This was originally developed in 1920 by Hollis E. Potter. The second image demonstrates the focus grid. The grid strips are parallel to the primary X-ray path across the entire image receptor.
A grid has three important dimensions: the thickness of the grid strip, the width of the interspace material, and the height of the grid. This is known as grid ratio. High grid ratios are more effective in reducing scatter radiation than low grid ratios. This is due to the smaller angle of deviation. However, high ratio grids increase the patient radiation dose. Generally, an 8:1 to a 10:1 grid is used. An alternative method for the use of radiographic grids is the air gap technique. This is another way of reducing scatter radiation, thereby enhancing image contrast. With the air gap technique, the image receptor is placed 10 to 15 centimeters away from the patient. A portion of the scattered X-rays generated in the patient would be scattered away from the image receptor and not be detected. The mass is increased approximately 10% for every centimeter of air gap. The technique factors are usually about the same for an 8:1 grid. One disadvantage of the air gap technique is image magnification with associated focal spot blur. The air gap technique has found application particularly in the areas of chest radiography and cerebral angiography. This video, though a little exaggerated, demonstrates the air gap technique. Notice how the patient herself absorbs the low-level energy photons, while a portion of the scattered X-rays generated in the patient would be scattered away from the image receptor and not be detected.
What effects does scatter have? Image quality is reduced when there is an increase in scatter, typically caused by higher KBP technique. Compton scatter has no useful information on a radiograph and results in a reduced image contrast. When scatter is increased, there is a direct increase in patient dose. Increased contrast ultimately results in image noise and a general dulling of the image. Image A has a duller appearance than compared to image B. Focus your attention on the ribs. The ribs on image B are more pronounced than can be seen on image A. Also, locating the carina on image A is a bit more difficult than with image B. Just one more example on how scatter affects the final image. See the difference? This demonstration shows how, with no collimation or beam-restricting devices, scatter reaches the IR and causes a reduction in image quality. When the hand is removed, you can see an obvious outline of scatter on the cassette. With proper collimation, X-ray photons would only hit the area of interest and nothing more. Scatter and patient dose. An increase in scatter means an increase to patient dose. The primary factors causing this is an increase in KVP, increased field size, and increased patient thickness. Obviously, patient thickness is not under the technologist's control, but the other two certainly are. Utilizing the appropriate KVP for each exam and always collimating to the anatomy of interest will help in the reduction of the radiation dose the patient is exposed to. This video demonstration provides a visual understanding of the amount of scatter produced when low KVP is used compared to when high KVP is used. When KVP is set at 60, the patient dose will be relatively low. As the patient walks out of the exam, the amount of scatter can be seen on his shirt. When KVP is increased to 80, the amount of scatter will also increase. As the patient walks out of this exam, it is apparent that the amount of scatter hitting the patient has increased.
Radiation protection. There are three important cardinal rules for radiation protection: time, distance, and shielding. Less time spent near the source, less radiation received. Greater distance from the source, less radiation received. Behind shielding from source, less radiation received. Protective barriers. Two types of protective barriers reduce the amount of scatter to reach the image receptor or technologist. Primary barriers are those that can only be struck by the primary beam exiting the X-ray tube. The floor and the ceiling are examples of primary barriers. In this video demonstration, once the exposure has been taken, you will notice that the wall, being the primary barrier, absorbs the scatter radiation. The secondary barriers can only be struck by scatter and leakage radiation. Walls, operating console booth, or window glass are examples of secondary barriers and used to protect the technologist. The secondary barriers in this clip would be the wall and glass. Once the exposure is taken, you will notice that it protects the technologist from any scatter that is produced from the patient. Lead aprons, lead gloves, lead glasses, and thyroid shields are applied to the technologist when performing a portable exam or during fluoroscopy procedures where scatter radiation is most produced. A standard 6 feet distance away from the X-ray source and ensuring the X-ray beam never exceeds the image receptor size will reduce the scatter radiation absorbed by the technologist. In this video, it will demonstrate why it's important to wear a lead apron. It is the only protective barrier protecting you from the scatter radiation coming off the patient.
In this video, we are performing a portable KUB on a larger patient and want to show how important it is to use a grid on this certain exam to help reduce the amount of scatter. We will also demonstrate how proper collimation is also another important factor. Always remember to wear a lead apron on any portable examination and keep your distance at a minimum of 6 feet during exposure.
phone. X-ray.
Hello.
How you doing today?
I'm doing
my name's Eddie. This is Andrea. We're going to be doing your X-ray today. Can I see your wristband? There you go. Mrs. Trump. Can I get your date of birth?
It's January 26, 87.
Awesome.
Lead aprons are made of 0.5 millimeters of lead to protect their technologists from scatter radiation.
Here, don't forget your grid.
Oh, yeah.
Radiographic grids are made with radiolucent and radiopaque material that absorbs the scatter radiation. It only allows radiation traveling in straight lines to pass through.
Are you hurting on your left side or your right side?
I think I can move around just fine. It's just my stomach.
Okay.
Hurting.
Well, I'm going to roll you to your right side, okay? We're going to put this cassette right behind you.
Okay.
So we're going to roll it that way. You ready?
1, 2, 3. Are you okay like that?
Yeah, it's pretty uncomfortable though.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'll just be for a minute.
Okay.
Collimators are beam-restricting devices that control scatter by limiting the beam to the area of interest.
Okay, that looks good. What kind of technique do you want?
I would say 80 at 100.
Okay.
Due to patient thickness, it requires high KVP. However, more scatter radiation is produced.
All right, ma'am, what I'm going to have you do is take a deep breath, and I'm going to have you let it all out, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to have you take a deep breath for me.
Hey, make sure you step back your 6 feet.
Increasing your distance decreases intensity, therefore limiting the possibility of scatter radiation to the technologist.
Set out, okay?
Okay. More work.
Hey, go back on your back.
Cool.
Do you need anything?
I'm okay. I could probably use a sandwich, but...
me too. Well, thank you, ma'am. Have a good day.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. like Beatles in the city. Be back immediately to confiscate the money.
Race girl. Wow.
What a rip off.
Hold on. We need more. Does yours reach?
No.
Oh, it's already falling off. You gotta be out.
You
gotta
cover your eyes. You gotta side it, man. Back and like, you know.
Oh, I'm recording you acting again.
Yeah, and I'll tell you in the background. Okay, go ahead and take this.
One, two, three. You're already ever.
Okay, chiropractor.
Okay, you ready?
Yeah, it's recording.
Pause it.
Hi, this is Trump. Hello, I'm Andrea, and this is Eddie. We're with X-Ray. Can I check your ID?
It's not coming out.
Living like an old geese. Quick release the cash, watch it fall slow.